Hi, my name is Damien Flynn. I'm an infrastructure architect for Lionbridge Technologies and a Microsoft MVP on System Center Cloud and Data Center Technologies. In this introduction video, we're going to take a quick look at Microsoft's brand new Windows Server 2012 Remote Access Services. Over the course of the next few moments, we're going to take a look at the environment needed to deploy Remote Access Services, some of the prerequisites, and then go through the process of actually configuring and deploying the infrastructure. To start off, we're going to require a domain controller, a server to be our direct access server, and some existing infrastructure that we can use as location services. My domain controller simply has Active Directory services, a DHCP, and working DNS. For the remote access server itself, we're going to install a public certificate for our users to connect to, the IIS role, which will be used for the IT HTTP tunnel, and the remote access services. So, let's get started. The prerequisites we need in place, of course, is Windows Server's brand new 2012 version and a public SSL cert, which we can grab from any of the main providers. Prior to starting the configuration of my remote access server, I visited godaddy.com and purchased a SSL certificate, which I later placed onto the C drive of my machine. I'm now going to use the certificate import wizard to import this certificate into the local computer store by simply providing the passwords that I've used to protect my certificate. This will enable my users to connect to my direct access and SSTP services without requiring any further certificate change to be put in place. In the new server manager dashboard on my remote access server, I can now use the Add Roles and Features wizard to prepare my server. Clicking through the wizard, all I require on the server roles is to enable the option for remote access, which will automatically determine any pre-required functions, features in Windows that need to be added and select those for me, thus allowing me to just click through the wizard through to the end and having the option to have the wizard also automatically restart my server should that be required once the roles and features have been installed. As you can see, this process is quite simple and simply requires a little bit of patience as the process completes. After a few moments, the wizard will complete and the server manager will update with a new node for remote access. Clicking on this, I have the ability then to launch the remote access console. As the remote access console launches for the first time, we are greeted with the configure remote access functions and two wizards. Launching the initial wizard, I have the choice of deploying full direct access with VPN technology, which starts off a four-step configuration with step one for configuring our clients. Here I choose that I want my clients to have full direct access functionality, and to determine which clients I will actually deploy this to, I've selected an Active Directory group which will contain the computer accounts for those machines which will be enabled for direct access. In order to help debug any issues, we also have an ability to define some servers within our environment which we would like these direct access clients to actually communicate and test with. This will be included in any of the debug logs we require. In my scenario, I'm picking one of my SQL servers from my lab and just validating that the direct access console can actually reach it currently. I also have the ability to add an email address and a friendly name for this connection, and finally set that my users can use local name resolutions in the event there are problems with their direct access connection. With that, we move on to step two, which is defining the actual remote access server. This wizard begins asking us the topology. My lab has a single interface which has NATed to a public IP address, and I provide the fully qualified domain name of the address my users will use to connect. This must match the SSL certs I provided from GoDaddy a little earlier. If your environment happens to have IPv6, you can now also identify a subnet which will be used for VPN connections from your clients. Please remember that direct access does not require or mandate that you already have an IPv6 environment. It now has a fantastic NAT 6-to-4 technology with full support for IPv4 only environments. Direct Access also offers support for Windows 7 computers. However, you must provide the root certificate authority to the Direct Access server, which matches the client computer certificates that you have already deployed to those Windows 7 machines before finally enabling the choice in the wizard. The final page in the Remote Access Server configuration defines both the address pool source, DHCP, and the authentication source, in this case Active Directory, for authenticating our tunnel connections. We can finally move on to step 3, and in step 3 we will define our infrastructure servers themselves. The first server we define is another internal server which is only available within your organization or your lab. This server is used to help your clients to automatically determine if they are sitting out on the internet and require a direct access tunnel, or if they are sitting within your lab slash offices and as a result do not need the direct access services. On the next page, we then define the actual suffix for your internal network and lab that will be passed to the DNS services of Direct Access. This is to enable both IPv6 and IPv4 support over your tunnels. The automatic configurations pretty much work out of the box for us. And finally, on the wizard, we get to define if we require some of our internal servers to manage the clients that are now connected to the tunnel. In my scenario, I'm deploying my Configuration Manager 2012 server as a management server for my network. This server must be IPv6 enabled. The final step in the wizard is not actually required to get up and going. This server is for additional protected services that you would like to offer to your users. We're going to skip that in the lab and click the finish button to review the settings that we have just defined. The wizard gives us a complete review of all of those options, including the IPs, the certificates, and of course the infrastructure configurations that we've just done. The infrastructure is the one area which you will probably revisit as you start adding additional domains and services that you would like to be supported through the Direct Access. Once you're satisfied that the settings are correct, you can have the wizard prepare to configure the environment. This is done through group policies. All of the settings the wizard generates are actually hosted and stored in two group policies, one which will be defined for your computers and the other which was defined for the actual Direct Access server. We'll take a look at those in a few moments. After the policies have been configured, the wizard completes its task and we can come back and visit the console. In the console, we can now review our settings, or we can take a little bit of time and proceed to maybe configuring our SSTP environment. From the console, to launch our SSTP, we can open up the Routing and Remote Access console. This is the same console we've seen from much earlier versions of Windows. From here, we simply launch the properties, and we can see that the security tab has already defined that we will use the SSL certificate that we defined a little bit earlier in our DA configuration to use the certificate offered from GoDaddy. Then, as we expand the server, we can see all of the different types of ports that our VPN server is listening for. I'm going to disable all of the different ports except for SSTP by simply double clicking on the properties and turning off the remote access connections for inbound to be disabled. And then finally, on the SSTP settings, I'm going to reduce the number of connections I'm going to supply from 128 to just reducing it into my lab for just 25 users. Applying these settings, we can now see that the ports has been reduced down from 128 to 25, and all of the other port technologies have as a result been removed. Back in the Remote Access Management console, we can now take a look around, and this should have been updated with its group policy refreshes. And after the group policy refreshes have complete, we'll start to see different operational statuses for our environment. Until such a time, that information will still be presented as not working. There are a number of different systems and modules that together combine to make the Direct Access service function, and the operational status page allows us to validate and ensure that all of those are in good health. To check the status of any of our clients, the Remote Access Client page allows us to see what clients have connected and using which technology. And finally, built into the box, we have support for reporting. The reporting can be using RADIUS or inbox Windows internal databases. I'm selecting the Windows internal database for my accounting system, and I'm going to store my data for 36 months, that's 3 years. Once I'm happy with those two settings, I simply need to apply, and the wizard once more will automatically complete the configuration. Those configurations, as before, are stored in group policies. As our users now start to connect to the environment, this reporting page and client status page will both update. Switching back to operational status, we can refresh one more time to ensure that the group policies have now all been applied, and if everything has gone to plan, we should see our direct access is now fully working properly. Switching back to the Windows Server Manager, we can launch the actual group policy console to take a look at those policies which were enabled. Those policies are, as we already mentioned, pointed at our clients, and as you can see, based on the security filtering, match the security group we defined in the very first step of our wizard. If we take a look at the settings of our group policy, these will represent all of the choices we chose as we worked through the wizard a little earlier. For the server settings, the group policy is also filtered, this time targeted only at the actual direct access server that we have worked on. Finally, remote access servers support multi-site deployment. Multi-site deployment allows us to group multiple direct access gateways under one direct access multi-site name, for example, my corporate remote access services. The wizard-driven configuration starts by requesting a name for our multi-site deployment and a friendly name which may be presented to our users for each of the different gateways as we add them to the multi-site. We have the ability to select if the users should be offered to select which gateway they can enter from. For example, this may be based on different geographical locations, or completely hide this fact and only offer the user based on their current position and the availability of existing direct access services. Only Windows 8 clients have the ability to automatically determine which direct access server is most suitable. To support Windows 7 computers in a multi-site environment, Active Directory groups containing each of the specific Windows 7 computers must be defined during the wizard. A Windows 7 machine can only be associated with a single direct access site. As with all previous configurations, once the wizard is complete, our group policies are updated and retargeted back to our direct access server. And once the direct access server has updated its group policies, the console will re-render, this time showing that we are in a multi-site configuration with the name of your enterprise and your gateways. All of the rest of the functionality of the console remains the same. Well, that's it. In 10 minutes, we have gone from zero to a fully deployed remote access service. Welcome to Windows 2012.